Welcome to part 5 of the lecture about competing reactions. Subject of today are seemingly trivial functional group transformations. Well, in a densely functionalized molecule, rather often you have a problem of competing reactions, for instance, within an oxidation. You have in this molecule, well, at least 3 positions which could be easily oxidized. The aldehyde, the nitrogen, could be transformed to an anoxide, and of course, an olefin, you could also oxidized to an epoxide or to a diol, and so on. Well, in this case, it was a synthesis started in Paul Grieco's group. With his doctoral student, William A. Carroll. Well, it was performed, or presumably finished, in 1992 and published in 1993. Well, the 2 last steps were just oxidizing this aldehyde functionality. First step, oxidizing. Secondly, an esterification to get this target product. It's a natural product, and its name is pseudotabazonin. Well, we couldn't go for really harsh forcing oxidizing conditions because of those competing reactions. But, well, the aldehyde usually is very easily to be oxidized. Unfortunately, not in this case. It just didn't work. Okay, normally we could imagine steric reasons or electronic reasons. One main reason should be electronic here, because such a conjugated aldehyde is, well, because of the stabilization through conjugation is more reluctant for being oxidized. And, well, you can see that as an vinylagous form amide. Okay, so the nitrogen would be directly attached to the carbonyl group. It would be a form amide, and this one is conjugated, a vinylagous one. So it didn't work. Pretty sure it was well meant to be the final steps of the PhD thesis of William Carroll. And he presumably said, damned, it doesn't work. Yeah. And then he went for an alternative. He said, well, okay, I should get rid of that carbonyl group, get rid of the benzyl group, and put on the ester functionality in one step. And he indeed finished that synthesis, as I said, with the following reaction conditions. First, 2 normal HCl at 100 degrees. Of course, you have to pressurize the flask. Secondly, treatment with neutral aluminum oxide and they isolated the intermediary product, the next stage with 81% yield, and as the third step, well, for a certain reason, I will write the name down, lithium 4-4 prime di tertiary butyl by phenolate. In THF, 87% yield. And what they isolated was the structure we talked about. Indeed, he got rid of the benzyl group and that formule functionality. Question: how does that work? Actually, these reaction conditions, just HCl, 110-20 degrees, are the reaction conditions for a decarbonylation, getting rid of the aldehyde functionality. Neutral aluminum oxide is just treating for purification neutralization, since you have been in an highly acidic environment. And of course, with two basic, highly basic centers, the enamine and that one, you have to neutralize. So, okay, this is the first exercise of today. Please try to figure out the mechanism how that bond here is cleaved and the formyl group is exchanged against a hydrogen mechanistically under these reaction conditions. Please have a try. So let's try to find the solution together. But first of all, we should cross out this reaction, since, as explained, this doesn't work. So, okay, let's have that partial structure. Again, the problem we have to solve is how can a bond, a C-C bond cleavage here, take place in the presence of HCl? We want to find the mechanism. Well, there are two ways to solve the problem. As we will do, we will think about where is that structure protonated. On the other hand, we could also think about if we would start with this molecule and want to introduce the formyl group, how would a formulation mechanistically work? And since all of those steps presumably are equilibrium reactions, then if we make a mechanism for the formulation of this compound and read it backwards, then we have the mechanism of the decarbonylation. Okay? So, what do we have here? As said before, this is a vinylicious carboxylic amide. And carboxylic amides are in equilibrium preferentially protonated at the carbonyl oxygen, Since then, you have that nice conjugated system. The cationic charge is stabilized by this mesomeric system. So, okay, and let's put on the retro arrow, since it's in equilibrium. Chloride and iron, and mesomeric structures. Okay, let's put on just one. This one. Well, the chloride and iron is a nucleophile present in close proximity. And in equilibrium, every now and then, a chloride will be attached here, and an enamine is formed. Next step, we are still in strongly acidic solution, HCl, high temperature. Once again, HCl. So now we have here this enamine carbon as a strongly basic position. Here it is preferentially protonated. So not to forget the chloride counter anion. Well, we also could say, well, maybe this is protonated here, okay? And then we get essentially to the same structure. But here, now nicely, this aluminium cation is electron deficient. Here, this is electron rich. And a fragmentation could take place like that. So, that's it. Here we have formyl chloride, and in principle, adding formyl chloride to an enamine in the presence of HCl as some kind of Friedel-Crafts catalyst. This is a Friedel-Crafts oscillation, essentially. You could go through that mechanism in this direction until here. Actually, not with HCl, but with aluminum chloride. So, aluminum chloride, HCl, and carbon monoxide. Let this mixture react with electron-rich aromatic systems, then it is the Gatterman-Koch formulation. Formulation or reaction. And Friedel-Crafts catalysts, HCl and carbon monoxide under high pressure. This is the industrial way to produce cheaply those aldehydes. We avoid that in the lab since we don't want to set up a reaction with an HCl bomb and carbon monoxide bomb and pressurize that. It's much easier to do a Filsmeier formulation, Filsmeier-Haag formulation, just with phosphor oxychloride and so on, as you know. And DMF and phosphor oxychloride. So the problem is this reagent. It is the acid chloride of formic acid, but you can't buy that. This is rather sensitive and decomposes already at minus 40 degrees rapidly. First, it has been proven that they had it in flask in solution by the famous Professor Stab in Heidelberg. Published in 1963 in Angewandte with a simple title, Formyl Chloride. That was the title of this paper. And how they did it with N-acyl imidazoles. It was known that with HCl, those will react, giving imidazolium chloride, which crystallizes out, plus the acid chloride. This was already known with various substituents R, and they tried it for hydrogen here in chloroform solution. And when keeping that and doing the reaction at minus 60 degrees, keeping that for a few hours at minus 60 degrees and then adding methanol, then methyl formiate was formed, and letting it warm up to minus 40 degrees, and then adding methanol, almost no ester formation was seen. That means minus 40 degrees already rapid decomposition of that into HCl and carbon monoxide. So. Well, back to Grieco's and Carroll's synthesis of the pseudo-tabazonin. Next step. That here. Treatment of the still benzylated, benzylated molecule with this reagent. Well, normally a benzyl protecting group, you get rid of it with palladium, hydrogen, and charcoal. Palladium, charcoal, and then hydrogen, bit of pressure. Well, the problem you would have is additional olefins which should be hydrogenated under these conditions. So, and this is a reducing agent which is suitable also for a debenzylation. 87% yield is good. Next exercise, please try to figure out the structure of that compound. So, that D-tertiary butyl biphenylide first of all, the biphenyl, and in 4-4 prime, we have tertiary butyl groups, and this should be an ion with the lithium counter cation, and this means we have a radical anion. Okay, you could draw those pi systems dotted throughout that. Sometimes you see that. Yeah. So the anionic charge and radical is is not localized at a certain position. And this is part of metal activation. Very similar to that system. Take naphthalene and sodium in THF, cool that, and also green color will appear of radical anion of naphthalene and a bit it behaves like solvated electrons. A very nice reducing agent. We have talked about that in the lecture of stoichiometric organometallics. For instance, one could use then these as reducing agents for producing Rieke metals. Having that in solution and having some salts, solubilized salts of some metals, reducing that in solution, and then you have fine, small particles of the metal highly activated. Okay, next example for a seemingly trivial functional group transformation we have in this molecule. Here it's about that olefin, just a hydrogenation, or better, reduction of double bond the group that undertook that synthesis of course tried the normal high pressure hydrogenation with palladium and charcoal, maybe platinum oxide also. It didn't work. No sign of that reduced. Should be steric reasons. Of course, such an octacycle is not flat. And then you have, in addition, some rather large side chains. And indeed, if you imagine that the usual hydrogenation, palladium catalyzed hydrogenation, is a heterogeneous reaction, and the reactive center has to come close to that surface, it could be a problem. However, there are some interesting methods with very small hydrogen transfer reagents that actually should not be that sensitive about steric hindrance. And the most prominent of that is the diimide. It's this. It indeed has an equilibrium slow transformation from the trans diimide to the cis, and the cis one is the one that nicely transfers its hydrogens to olefins and alkynes. It's a cis transfer forming molecular nitrogen. This reagent is quite easy produced in solution. You don't want to have that in gram quantities pure. Clearly, you don't want that. But you can produce that, generate that in situ easily if you start from hydrazine having oxygen, respectively just air, copper sulfate in ethanol H2O. There are nice protocols in organic syntheses, which are very nicely worked out in detail and are very safe and easy to follow. From organic syntheses is the example of hydrogenating this macrocycle with two trans olefins and one cis olefin and selectively with a nice yield, the trans olefins are hydrogenated faster compared to the cis one, and this could be isolated. Well, one example that was tried in my group a couple of years ago with the with this reagent, the diimide, is this molecule, hoping for a cis hydrogenation at this olefin that all five aryl groups with those alkoxy groups are on the same side of a cyclopentane ring. But you can imagine that this is then sterically really overcrowded. And we made some calculations that eliminating hydrogen, going backwards, is hexagonic. Okay. So, and therefore, the diimide reduction didn't work in this case, not so surprisingly, but surprisingly, it also didn't work here in this case. So, how did that group then manage to synthesize that molecule? Well, they took the open chain compound hydrogenated that with normal conditions, just one atmosphere pressure, hydrogen, 10% palladium on charcoal, got nicely the hydrogenated product. But of course, then facing the problem of having to do a lactonization to a medium-sized ring. This is always a problem. You need special reaction conditions optimizing that. And the conditions they were using was pyridinium disulfide, no, dipyridyl disulfide. It's this structure. With one equivalent of triphenylphosphine. And in this case, sorry. The mixed thioanhydride is produced plus triphenylphosphine oxide. And now this has to be activated as a leaving group, and this activation is achieved by treating this with a sulfur and silver cations. Silver tetrafluoroborate in toluene reflux temperature and an overall yield of 73% for the 8-membered ring lactone. That one. Okay, I think this is enough for today. We go on tomorrow with problems with stereochemistry. Thanks for listening. See you tomorrow afternoon.